So, Jon Kindel, this is the first time that you and I are talking. And first of all, how are you today?
I'm doing wonderful. How are you?
I am also wonderful. And I feel especially glad because I've had some requests as of late to have the next spotlight be someone who is a developer. And so I believe that you're the first spotlight show with a developer.
Very cool. Very cool. Well, hopefully it'll be the first of many.
Okay, good to hear. So please, John, for anyone who doesn't know, what would you say your rough and ready job title is?
Backend lead developer. So it's kind of a position that wears multiple hats where you have a little bit of time, hands-on with the code, but then, you're also organizing and really structuring more big picture type tasks. So, rather than attempting to write everything yourself, you're kind of guiding and helping others in creating a larger project.
Wow. All right. Well, we will definitely dig into that in a bit. But before we go any further, I like to get a sort of establishing picture of where various people are in the world. Whereabouts do you stay?
So I am just north of Denver, Colorado.
Denver, Colorado. Right on. And now, how did you come to Dash?
That is a long story. And so I guess I'll kind of start from the beginning and we can kind of just go from there.
Okay.
I first learned about Bitcoin, in late 2013. A employee of mine was actually, he kind of told me about it. And at first I was like, this doesn't make any sense. But then I started looking deeper into it and I kind of started to realize, this does really feel like the way of the future. And unfortunately, it feels like I missed out on it. And
Oh.
so that was the feeling that I was left with. But, now I kind of realized that was completely wrong. It was the beginning of something, but, something much, much greater, at least from my perspective. So at that point, I started looking into altcoins. So I started with Litecoin and I mean, just a lot of other coins. So this was like right towards the beginning of 2014. And I was running some mining rigs because I realized that, hey, I'll just mine some altcoins and see what this is all about.
It's wild how many of
And
you guys got started in mining.
yeah, it was so much fun.
Okay.
I can share a little bit of a funny story about that. So it was 2 weeks after I'd started mining. And at that point, I had one graphics card, and I had that in the upstairs computer room. And this thing was the loudest thing you can possibly imagine. So it sounded like an airplane was taking off pretty much 24/7. So
Whoa.
my girlfriend's father ends up coming over to visit out of the blue. I'm off at work at the time. I have this like hair blower running in the office, so she's trying to explain to him what I'm doing. So ultimately, that led to me moving my mining rig down to the garage where it stayed for about a year. I scaled it out a little bit. But somewhere along the way, I ended up finding what was then known as Darkcoin. And I was like, wow, this is like a coin that actually offers something beyond Bitcoin. And it's not trying to add unnecessary features. It's really fundamentally looking at what Bitcoin is doing, and it's looking at ways to make it better. So I've kind of been following the project since then. So like around February, March 2014. Throughout that year, I was mining and just getting more into the field itself. It must have been around the same time in 2015. There was some threads on what was then known as darkcointalk.org about making the wallet look nicer. I was like, this maybe it could be something I could help with. I've been into website dev work and CSS and all that stuff since I was like 12 years old. And I was like, well, this might be kind of cool. And I just saw a lot of talk about it for a long time. It's like, well, someone's got to get this going. So I just kind of reached out. Another developer still on the team named Crowning was the gentleman that I ended up working on that with.
Okay.
So it was kind of an interesting project, and that was really my first foray into any type of cryptocurrency development, even though it wasn't really crypto, it was just making it look nice. That was kind of
Right.
my first, foray into doing that stuff. So we spent
Okay.
a couple months on that, and that was right around the time actually that Darkcoin became Dash. So it was kind of cool being, at least to a certain extent, kind of involved in that because we took the theme that I had created for Darkcoin And then, you know, we just moved that over to Dash, and that's like the two kind of ended up lining up nicely.
Mm-hmm. Well, now before I begin to ask you more about what it is that you do now and how you transitioned from making the wallet look prettier to being the backend development lead, I want to get a bit more about your background. You had mentioned something like one of your employees told you about Bitcoin. So what is it that you were doing professionally before you came to Dash?
I was the IT manager for a company based out of Colorado. I don't want to name the name of the company, but it was a really interesting concept. It was a strategic business coaching franchise, and it was actually quite interesting. Now, their main focus wasn't on IT. You know, they primarily wanted to help small to medium-sized business owners to make their business better.
But you part did of their IT.
I did, yeah.
Yeah.
And so part of their offering was a set of online tools. So they're basically like strategic coaching tools and things like that. So I started at that company as a help desk guy, which I did for a few years. And, you know, I kind of liked that job just because it was kind of nice being able to help people and do stuff like that. And then after that, I kind of moved over to the IT management role, where I really started to play a much more direct role in those online tools. And the gentleman who told me about Bitcoin ended up taking the role that I had previously.
So now, so fast forward to today then, I guess you gave us a brief overview of what it is that you do, but would you care to paint us, like, I don't know if you have a day in the life, or I almost don't even know enough about what it is to do what you do to ask an accurate question. So
yeah,
I guess I'm hoping that you can pull me out of this water here.
I will do my best. So a day in the life. Yeah, let's just kind of go from there, and then maybe I can talk a little bit about my teammates, the processes we go through, stuff like that. So, you know, I've actually been really fortunate. So, you know, I started working full time on Dash at the start of this year. Last year, I kind of worked my full-time job while also working on Dash part-time. And eventually, the paths kind of aligned where I had the opportunity to work on Dash full-time. Now, it was kind of an interesting question for me as well. You know, how do I manage my day moving from kind of a structured 9-to-5 type of thing into a much more decentralized, more loosely defined type of position? So the day in the life of John, at least as it's developed over the last few months, and things could certainly change, starts out with a meeting with Andy Freer and the rest of the core devs. You know, we just kind of talk about any issues that may have come up. We use that really as an opportunity to game plan the rest of our day, or at least for me, it works out that way because that meeting is at 8 a.m. After that, it really just depends on the day, actually. The organizational structure that we're using is kind of an interesting one, where it's really a collection of smaller groups. So we have the core group, and I had mentioned that we have that daily stand-up. At the start of each week, I have a meeting on Monday with a group of guys who are working on some things relating to API services and wallet type things. On Tuesday, I have another kind of standalone meeting or more focused meeting, really with other people who are working on kind of the SDK wrapper and you know, various things like that. So it's a little bit fluid in that sense, where I kind of find myself doing about one third of the time working with my teammates, really just kind of touching base and seeing where things are. And then the remainder of that time is either drilling into projects, meaning coding, or looking more at like the system architectural side of things, just in terms of how everything fits together.
Okay.
So yeah, it's honestly kind of a difficult question to answer, I guess. Because it's very very fluid type of situation.
Yeah, it sounds it. Well, and that prompts a question for me, which was, I was under the impression that you were the back-end lead for, you know, what is being called Evolution, but, you know, you let me know that you were the back-end lead in general. So I guess that just prompts the question from me, which is, when Evolution is released, will that remake, like, all of Dash? Like, basically, would one still be able to use the Dash Core wallet in a non-evolution way? You know, like, will the two things still be compatible?
Yeah, and let me zoom out that question just a little bit, because so far I'm only speaking to the parts of the team that I touch, right?
Okay.
And there's actually quite a bit more. You can almost split it up into like a quadrant where, on the one hand, we have the core devs. Those are guys that are working on the QT wallet. They're working on the 12.1 release that just came out. On my end, I have the API, which is really the front end facing part of the system. So really what I'm talking about is just that bottom left quadrant where we're looking at building the architecture that allows for lightweight wallets or Android apps, things like that, to be able to connect to the Dash Core part of the network. So really, I'm just focused on just that one part. And what's really interesting is, because it's arranged that way, you know, there's no precedence of evolution eventually trumping core or core. Really, they're just all parts of the same system, and they're really intended to work alongside each other. And I think that that's just kind of one thing to keep in mind from that perspective.
How much of like the coding itself would you say you do versus like management of coders who require direction from like a higher level viewpoint?
You know, I would say it's kind of in flux. You know, our team has been growing. We've been adding a new developer, about one per month, for the last few months here. So a lot of that has been, you know, onboarding people and doing things like that. And actually, the start of this year, it was like 80% coding. And then right now, it's probably 50% coding. Mm-hmm. So it really just kind of ebbs and flows, I think, depending a lot on where we are in the overall project flow.
And when you do code, what is it that you're coding in? What language are you writing in, out of curiosity?
So I am writing in Node.js primarily. So JavaScript/Node.js are kind of the same thing. A lot of work was spent by me last year porting Bitcore from Bitcoin over to Dash. And so also a pretty significant part of our backend infrastructure is also kind of built off of that same code base, which is also JavaScript.
I see. So shifting gears a bit, what would you say your favorite thing is to do in Dash? You know, whether it's coding or guiding, or like, what is it that is most like, oh, that was great. I want more of that.
Yeah. No, I think it has to be the coding. And that was really one of the biggest reasons that I decided to go into Dash full time. At my last job, it was all like management. And it got so frustrating not being able to at least occasionally go hands-on with this stuff. And so I think that that is definitely my favorite part of it.
All right. So now, I don't know if you are even, you know, at liberty to say, but I would just ask, do you know if the timeline that Ryan Taylor gave for Evolution Alpha and Evolution First public release, which in Miami he said was Alpha approximately this summer and public release by the end of the year. Do you know if that is still the case?
I think it's still a reasonable goal. Yeah. I mean, we've been building out scopes, and really a lot of it just depends on, do we want functionalities A through Z to be included in that alpha release, or do we only really care about A, B, and C? Mm-hmm. And so really a lot of that timing has to do with what features we want to release and make public, and when, but I do feel that we are on the right track. So I wouldn't anticipate any delays beyond what he had mentioned or anything like that. Mm-hmm.
And now for anybody who, like yourself, has various coding skills and is familiar, even intimately familiar with much of what code goes into Dash, be it, you know, the core itself, or like you said, like various APIs, libraries, Bitcore, what have you. I'm sure you're laughing inside your mind. You're like, Amanda, those things aren't even related. but for anybody who would say want to join Dash as a developer, as you have, do you have any sort of like recommendation of a path that they might take, or are you aware of any sort of glaring openings that you yourself would like to see filled?
Yeah. So, I mean, I think a very important thing of building any type of team is really getting to know that person. And, you know, from my own personal experience, when I really decided to go all in on Dash, it was actually at the end, at the start of last year. So what I did was I actually reached out to Evan. He had posted something on Bitcoin Talk looking for JavaScript developers. I was like, hey, I would love to do that. At that time, really, I wanted to just contribute to the project. And the first 6 months, actually, you know, I didn't get paid for doing so. But I think what that really allowed me to do was to get a better sense of the organization and for Dash to get a better sense of what I'm all about, too. So I would definitely ask that any developers that are interested in joining the project be open to maybe not a full year time frame, because that's a really long time to be doing that, but be willing to invest a little bit of their own time to allow us to get to know them and vice versa. And really that ends up being, in my opinion, the best way for someone who would like to be able to contribute to the project to do so. Mm-hmm. In terms of skill sets, it's going to be, I think, broadening over time. So on the backend dev, so like the Evo API and all those types of things, primarily we need JavaScript and Node. At the present time, I think that we're pretty good with the team that we have. I've been, you know, really trying to cultivate that over the last number of months. I know we are looking for anyone with knowledge in C++ and crypto. That's kind of a difficult mix to find.
That's what I keep hearing.
Yeah. Yeah. So as far as I know, you know, we are always looking for those guys. And then, you know, anyone who does have a knowledge in JavaScript and would like to just help out, you know, I think that, you know, just send us your info. And, you know, if it ends up lining up well, I might have some non-critical task that you can at least start to kind of wrap your head around the code base. Get to know us, give us a chance to also get to know you.
Mm-hmm. And when you say contact us, by what means would you recommend?
So I would just shoot an email. You can send it to john@dash.org.
Got it. Okay. Yeah. Well, I really just have one final question for you, John, which is, do you have any sort of, how do you see Dash being used in something like 5 or 10 years? I know that all of us will have a different sort of answer to this because we all see Dash in a different way. For example, yeah. I cannot even fathom how you see Dash because you write the code for it. So I'm just interested to see, you know, there's no right or wrong answer here, basically, is what I'm saying.
So where do I see Dash in 5 to 10 years? I see Dash moving beyond simply being a payment network. Honestly, that's where I see it going. Though it's, you know, I mean, it's a really interesting cycle where the value of Dash maintains value because it's used as a store of value, which then incentivizes miners, right? But there's a whole lot of other things that a decentralized ledger can do. I mean, when you look at accounting uses various accounts. So those are objects. And that's very much what we're building within evolution. So I think that really the sky is the limit in that regard, because we haven't yet even really figured out what's capable or feasible within this type of platform. But so that's kind of a vague answer, but I ultimately see it evolving way beyond being simply a payments network.
Interesting. Well, I'm glad to hear you use the word accounting, because I've begun using that word more lately as well, accounting as a service, with hopefully money as, you know, the first service that people choose to subscribe to.
Yeah. I mean, I think that pretty much nails it. I mean, when you look at double entry accounting, you know,
would you mind
you don't
telling
just...
me what that means, by the way? I've heard that term so many times, and I don't know what it means.
It's a way of balancing out a balance sheet, which is another accounting term, but it's a way of accounting for, so let's say that you're person A, I'm person B, and I owe you some money, okay? So on my books, I have a accounts payable, and then I also have a cash account, and I have all these different parts. What that allows me to do is really to track not only the actual transfer of those funds, but the fact that I owe you funds. And then when I transfer those funds, the double entry part is basically balancing the other sheet. And it's a lot of
For my account to have had a gain, your account must have a perfectly proportional loss. That's like the double entry.
It is. So what you'd want to look at then is how do you balance those things? And you do that using debits and credits. So depending if it's an asset or a liability, a debit is either going to increase or decrease a balance, and then a credit simply offsets that.
I see. All right.
And so right now we're only recording the transactions, but I think that's a really apt metaphor for the fact that you can do a lot more than that. So.
Okay. Well, my goodness, what a dangling apple is set 5 to 10 years in the future.
I know, it's just wonderful, isn't it?
If I weren't motivated to hang on for that long, I think I probably would be now, just having sort of heard you say that. So, you've already given your email address, John. Is there anywhere else where you would prefer people to contact you or follow you in any social kind of way?
You can probably find me on LinkedIn. I'm also on there. I'm LinkedIn with Ryan and a bunch of the other guys there, so you can find me there. I occasionally hang out on the Dash Nation Slack, so I do have a user account there. So feel free to message. Yep, that's it.
Right on.
And yeah.
All right. Well, thanks for your time, John, aka Smogcell, and I imagine we will again catch up one day in the future.
Thank you for having me.